here tonight. What a great crowd. This is going to be a lot of fun. I'm Barbara Lane. I'm the Director of Arts and Ideas here at the JCCSF. Thank you for coming. Take a moment now, silence your cell phones. You will have an opportunity to ask questions of Cheryl Strayed. Our staff will be out in the audience with microphones. Please wait for them to get to you so your questions are audible. Cheryl Strayed will sign books following tonight's program out in the atrium. Our good friends from Books, Inc., one of San Francisco's fine independent bookstores, are here selling books. Yay! We love the independents. So please take advantage of the opportunity to buy a book and have it signed by Cheryl Strayed. Just one quick note on an upcoming program. Mark Maron, the comedian, WTF podcast, will be here on May 16th. We're going to partner with Sketchfest on that. Get your tickets. They're going fast. Did everybody get to see the fashion show tonight? Well, wait a minute. So just a little plug for Ruti, the boutique. It's the brainchild of Ruti Zisser, dedicated to showcasing top Israeli design. All of the designers are Israeli. If you've been to Tel Aviv lately, you know the fashion is just crazy great there. The first Ruti store opened in Palo Alto, and now there are two more, one in San Francisco, right down here on Fillmore Street, and another in Santa Monica. Our staff and friends had a really good time with the fashion show, and we hope you enjoyed it. And now for tonight's program. When she was 22, following the death of her mother and breakup of her marriage, Cheryl Strayed made the decision to hike the Pacific Coast Trail from the Mojave Desert to Washington State, and to do it alone. To say she was spectacularly unprepared is an understatement. Cheryl Strayed recounts that grueling physical and emotional journey in Wild, a book that has resonated with millions of readers in its unflinching depiction of loss and grief and the road to acceptance and recovery. Cheryl Strayed also wrote the novel Torch, and last year she was revealed to be the author of the unconventional advice column Dear Sugar, published online in The Rumpus. Yeah, let's hear it for Sugar. We're delighted to have Cheryl Strayed here tonight. Please join me in welcoming her to the JCCSF. You are a rock star. You're a rock star.
Well, San Francisco always makes me feel that way.
Well,
so
boy.
Thank you.
But you know, it occurs to me when I was doing some research for this interview online, people feel such an intimacy with you because of your book, certainly. And they write Cheryl this and Cheryl that as if they really, really know you intimately. They assume a familiarity with mm-hmm. you. But to a large degree, the you they know from Wild is 20-something, and here we are these many years later.
That's right.
So how do you handle that assumption of familiarity?
Well, I'm much milder now, that's for sure. If I followed it Wild up with, it would be called Mild.
And if I
had told the whole story, it would have been called really wild. But you know,
well,
I had to.
So let's start with what you left out.
Yeah, there are some things I left out. The word clitoris is one. Honestly, it's true.
Why?
Because, you know, it's so funny. My editor, Robin Desser, who's this fabulous editor at Knopf. So there, those of you who've read the book, you know, I had sex with, we're just getting right down to it right away, aren't we?
Why waste time?
I had sex with this guy on the beach in Oregon. Mm-hmm. And in the course of that scene, there was the word clitoris, as there should be, right? I mean,
I hope.
And I mean, you know, and so, but she thought it was too sort of porno. And so then I was like, well, how about clit? And she said, that's worse. And then I said, okay, I give up. And so I took it out, and then later I thought, well, I should have probably fought harder for the clitoris. So if you could go, you can go to that page in the book and just add that in the marginalia.
So just to get back to this whole idea of intimacy for a moment.
We weren't talking about that kind of intimacy.
Not that kind of intimacy.
But, people.
They think they know you. And do you think it's because you're, we've all had loss.
Right.
Do you think it's that experience of loss that resonates so much, or something about the nature of the journey you undertook, or you've spent a lot of time, as we discussed, talking about this book. And it just seems to me a really unusually personal emotional response that people have to it.
Yeah, I think that what they're responding to is certainly that. You know, every time I get an email or have a conversation with somebody about the book, the first line is that they liked Wild, and then the next three paragraphs are essentially their story. You know, what piece of the book resonated with them? What parts of their life or consciousness was sparked or ignited by what they read in Wild, which I think is really interesting. I also started to get so many emails from people who were saying, it's uncanny we have led parallel lives. I mean, I'm sure there are some people in the room who believe yourselves to have lived a life parallel to mine. And at first I thought that was just kind of weird, and then as time passed I realized there are so many of us who feel we live those kinds of lives, and it's because we do, you know, that there is so much more about our very original and unique experiences that are universal, more than we would think. Mm-hmm. And those things, you know, that remains true across cultures, across age and gender and all of those things. I was saying to you earlier, you know, half of my fan mail is from men. I last week met a woman from Korea. She said she was just visiting the United States, and my book has been published there, and she said, you're a celebrity in Korea. And I said, really? I had no idea. And I said, well, what did people say about the book? And she told me what they are saying about the book there, and it's the exact same thing they're saying about the book here, mm-hmm. which I thought was really beautiful.
Yeah.
But I think, too, that thing that you said, the me that you all got to know in Wild, you know, that the story is the 26-year-old me, but the consciousness is the 44-year-old me, or the 40-year-old me who wrote the book, you know? And so even though in the book I'm not saying in any explicit ways, or at least only towards the end, where I say, you know, this is really me reflecting upon this experience, the consciousness that's behind each word, all of the decisions I made, the way I crafted that story was born out of who I am now.
Well, you do play with time in the book. And so tell me about the decision to structure the book the way you did. Is that how it started out, or did you come to that after experimenting?
Right. So the book, for those of you who haven't read the book, I should say it's about this 1,100-mile hike I took on the PCT in the summer of 95. And one of the things that when I knew that I was going to write about that journey, that immediately gave me a chronology. There's no better way to tell the story of a hike than to start at the beginning and end at the end, right? It doesn't make any sense otherwise. And so what was great is I could hang the rest, the more important story, on the spine of that trail, mm-hmm. of that hike. And so one of the things I came to really right away is that the beginning of every chapter, you would be on the trail in some way, and you would be further down the trail than you were before. And then from there, I could weave in and out of chronology and essentially tell you what happened before the trail. Who was this woman in this moment of her life? And sometimes, you know, I would spin back in time and I would be six, and sometimes I would spin back in time and it would be 5 months before my hike. Mm-hmm. And that I was really, I guess the most thinking went into, you know, when do I tell you about this versus this?
Did you have stickies all over your wall?
You know, not really. I tend to be, I sort of work very intuitively, and there was a point, so meaning by which I mean I write and I can feel almost, like a heat, like this is the, for example, there's this scene where I meet this man, Greg, and we are in this hotel, and he's in the room next door, and I'm feeling like maybe, you know, at that time in my life, I was just so used to getting essentially love or attention from men by being sexually attractive to them, and I'm thinking about, should I approach him and come on to him, essentially, and I thought, you know, just very intuitively that that was the place to tell you about my father. You know, so if you read that chapter, there I am in the room, and then we spin back mm-hmm. in time, and I tell you the story of my father, and you know, his abuse of my mother and his role in my life, which was not a positive one. Mm-hmm. And by doing that, I wasn't trying to make a direct line between my sexuality at that age and the fact that I had been abused and abandoned by my father. But I think that those putting those things side by side mm-hmm. certainly is psychologically relevant.
Absolutely. Yeah. Well, I read where you wrote somewhere that becoming hypersexual after suffering loss is not uncommon. Uh-huh. And this is something that happened to you. And as I was reading this book, I kept wondering, how does your ex-husband, Mark, feel about your
telling? Well, I call him Paul in the book.
You, sorry?
He's called Paul in the book.
He's called Paul in the book?
I don't know how you know his real name, but now we all do.
Whoops.
Okay. We're getting real here. So I don't know how he's going to feel about that, but anyway. So Paul, a.k.a. that name that we're forgetting. Okay.
Right. Sorry.
That's okay. So anyway, what was the question? How does he feel?
How did he feel about the revelations of your sexuality? Because you had broken up, but
right.
you were certainly involved with other men before you broke up because you were just so undone
right.
by this loss that uh-huh. you were...
Well, first of all, he knew everything that was in the book. Not that I vetted the book with him, but in our lives, when we were breaking up, it was actually one of the most powerful experiences I've ever had, because we actually broke up well. You know, we really went very far into our intimacy. We went very far into trying to figure out whether we should come apart or stay together. And we parted with a great amount of love and respect. Mm-hmm. And that never diminished over time. And so actually, when I came to San Francisco last year, almost exactly a year ago, I think it was like April 9th or something, I read at Book Passages, and I went out for dinner afterwards with friends and went back to my hotel room and checked my email. And at this, you know, I was getting hundreds of emails from readers saying, you know, things about the book. And so I'm scanning my email, and I open up this email, and I'm midway through reading it when I realize it's from my ex-husband, and he's read the book. And suddenly my heart just, you know, started pounding, and he wrote the kindest email about the book. He thanked me for writing about our relationship so honestly and also gently. You know, of course there are many, many, many things I could have written about our relationship that aren't in the book. You know, he wasn't a perfect human being, he was mm-hmm. a human. Mm-hmm. But there were things that I felt a great amount of responsibility to both tell the truth and, you know, not invade his privacy. You know, I changed his name, I mean, up until now. you know, so just in case he didn't until tonight want to raise his hand and be like, you know, that was me. But what's funny is he has two teenage daughters, and we have a mutual friend who said, oh yeah, the girls are like so excited every time they go to the dentist or whatever, they see Wild in some magazine or, you know. So I was surprised he's shared this with his kids.
And he's proud of you.
Yeah, he is.
So when you decided to take the hike, did you know there'd be a book? And tell us about your journaling process.
Right. I didn't know there would be a book. You know, I was a serious writer at the time, and I always think that, you know, anything that happens in, you know, it can end up in anything I write. Half of the things I write about in the sugar column that come from my life, I never imagined I would write about them. And so anything's up for grabs, but I certainly, when I was on the hike, did not think, okay, this would make a great memoir. And in fact, for years, my husband, whose real name is Brian, who I am actually married to, he would say, you should write about the PCT. And I would always say, you know, I don't have anything to say about it. It was an interesting journey, and it would make for great conversation. But until I really had something to say about that experience that transcended the experience. You know, we've all had adventures and traumas and dramas, and that doesn't make a book. And so until I reached that place as a writer and a human, that I understood what this experience meant and felt like I could bring that to bear on the story, I didn't want to write it.
So much of the journey is about your mother's death. It's mm-hmm. really at the center of this book. But you had also written about that in
right.
Torch,
yeah.
in your novel. Mm-hmm. So why did you decide to revisit it? And as you said, you had something else to bring to it. Was it just time and your understanding, or what
right.
was it?
Well, Torch, you know, in Wild, when I say there was this book I was writing in my head, it was Torch. And Torch, that's another reason I couldn't write Wild, because Torch was the book I had to write. Mm-hmm. And I think every writer has that first book that absolutely has to be born. And I needed to tell this story in a fictional way that, you know, is strongly drawing on autobiography. And it wasn't just my story, it was the story of a family and a community. And so I just was passionate about that story. And then when I went to write my next book, I didn't choose to revisit my mother's death or my grief. It was something that I have just been obsessed with as a writer. And so it was like I when I first started writing Wild, I didn't know that my mother's death would actually be such a big part of the book. Mm-hmm. I don't know why, what I was thinking, because it's such a big part of the book. But it was just, it's something that I have had to write about over and over and over again. It's incredibly powerful to me. And I think, you know, and then you see this also in some of the Dear Sugar columns. You know,
yes.
Another strand is there. And, you know, this next book I'm writing is a novel, and I haven't gotten very far into it, and I don't think that there are any dead mothers in it, you know? And I'm so happy about that. But I don't know. I mean, that's the thing about writing, is you set out with this intention, and then what you have is something else.
You know, a couple of things about your mother. You mentioned the way you write about your ex-husband, that he wasn't perfect. The way you write about your mother in this book, in Wild, one of the most poignant parts of the book to me is when you addressed her shortcomings.
Mm-hmm.
And you talked about all the things your mother did that
right.
weren't so great. And that just served to make her so much more human.
Right.
And it was just a really beautiful part, I thought.
Thank you.
Of the way you spoke about your mother, because before I thought, oh my God, her mother went to college with her, how cool, and her mother did
right,
this,
right.
and her mother did that, but then you talked about some of the other things that weren't so great, and it really made her more real and
yeah.
more fully developed, and I was able to better understand the loss in a more real way.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was a really hard chapter for me to write, because even though I know otherwise, I think that there is that instinct that we feel when someone we really love dies, that, you know, that you would never speak a word against them. And that in some ways, if you do that, that's a betrayal mm-hmm. of that person and your love. But, you know, I really needed to do that. And that day on the trail, when it was her 50th, again, for those of you who hasn't read the book, not to shame you. Okay. So...
I think everybody else has memorized it.
Exactly, yeah. Right, exactly. We'll be reciting chapter one together later. So I was about 2 months into my hike, and I woke up, and it was August 18th, my mother's 50th birthday. And she died when she was 45, and I loved her so much. I loved her, you know, beyond measure, and she was really my only parent. And so I just had never gotten sort of angry. I'd never gone through those feelings that you naturally feel in your teens and early 20s, where it's developmentally appropriate for you to be separating from your parents in some way, and being very critical and condemning them about, you know, things that you think they did wrong, whether you're right or not about that. And so I never got to do that, because my mom got sick and died. And then I had to be her loyal daughter. And there was something that came unhinged on that day, that it was her 50th birthday. So in this chapter in the book, I write about my rage, and I make a list of the things that, all the things that I can think of that my mom did wrong, all the things, ways that she failed me. And it was like a kind of release, I think, mm-hmm. where I gave myself permission, you know, for me to finally do that developmental thing of detaching from my mom and moving on. And she became more human to me too. I mean, one of I would have my mother back in a flash, absolutely. But there are also a few things that have happened because my mom died that I got to learn things. I got to experience things that I couldn't have otherwise, and I got to know things that I couldn't have otherwise. And one of those things is I got to see my mother as a human being much earlier than most people get to see their mothers as a human being. Because I think, I don't know that you can fully do that for some time for most people, because our mothers, of course, are who they are in relation to us. What they give us, what they didn't give us, you know, all, so much of that relationship is hinged on those things. And when my mom died, and after a few years, it was like I could release her from me, and she could just be a person who wasn't just my mom.
You've become, and I don't know how comfortable you are with this, but you've become something of a guru to people who've lost mothers.
Which is
people
ridiculous.
Come to you with their stories, yeah. But then this plays out in your Dear Sugar columns. You have what Steve Almond, who preceded you as Sugar and gives you all the credit in the world for where you've taken that column, calls radical empathy. Mm-hmm. That clearly comes, that perspective comes from this loss you have. And one of the most painful and effective Dear Sugar columns that I read, was to a man who'd lost his son. And your empathy and the perspective you have in talking to him, and I want you to say a little bit about that, comes out of your pain and your loss.
Absolutely. It's a column called The Obliterated Place. And it was a letter, this man, his 22-year-old son had been killed by a drunk driver. And he said that he was suffering. You know, he was going on in all the ways that you're expected to go on. He, you know, was seeing a counselor, and he was, you know, still working his job, and he had a healthy romantic relationship with his girlfriend, and yet he still could not accept the fact that his son, his only child, had been taken from him. You know, this person he loved more than anyone. And he wrote to me and said, it was a powerful letter, but one of the things he said is, help me be human again. And I, even just talking about this letter, it just makes me feel like I'm just going to burst into tears right now. Because it's so, his pain was so powerful. It was just like, it was like so gigantic, it was almost like had a physical manifestation. It was like a gigantic apple or something you could hold in your hands. And I knew that I had to answer his letter, and I also knew that I didn't know what to give him. And so I grappled with it for days on end. And what I really realized is that, you know, none of us can actually take away each other's suffering. You know, what I want is my mom back. You know, and nobody can give that to me. But what we can give each other is, I think, simply, you know, the presence of our being and the presence of our compassion. And to offer to witness, in witnessing that kind of giganticness of his grief, I think in some ways it's that we're holding it. Mm-hmm. And by witness, I mean not turn away from it. One of the things that was so painful to me in the years after my mom died is how often people would want to help me by denying the grief or denying even the very existence of my mother, as if maybe I had just forgotten about her if they didn't mention her, you know?
Because you weren't allowed to be sad.
Not allowed to be sad. And so in my response to this man, I say, you know, your grief is gigantic. And your job, like the only thing you can do with it, is to make something of it. And to make it beautiful. And I think that in so many ways, like that's what I've tried to do with my writing, in the writing I've done about my grief, is tried to create something that was beautiful out of something that was ugly, you know?
The ugliest thing. By the way, go ahead.
The ugliest thing transformed into a beautiful thing.
Well, that column is in the collection, Tiny Beautiful Things, and if you have not read it, The Obliterated Place, do. another thing that occurred to me when I was reading Wild, we've had Gabrielle Hamilton here on this stage who wrote Blood, Bones, and Butter, and one of the things she said that struck me was the fact that she had been poor was really important to who she became. You have been poor.
I have
been. And you have been hungry. And that's something that not many of us have experienced. And that really did make you who you are.
It did.
Can you talk about that and sort of how that was necessary for
you? Yeah, you know, it's, I think, I mean, we always talk about how class is so hard to talk about, and it is, it's really a hard, I don't know why it's so hard to talk about, but one of the things I hope to do in the course of my writing career is to really figure out how to write better about that and how to shed some light in that sort of thing. But, you know, I would say it affected me, you know, in positive and negative ways, and mostly over time, you know, in the end, positively. I mean, I never had a lesson as a kid. I never went to a camp. I never got to, you know, join anything. I always had...
You didn't have plumbing.
I didn't have a toilet. That's right, yeah. That's true. Good point. So there was that, too. I mean, forget it. You can't have piano lessons if you have an outhouse, you know. But you know, what I did have is a very resilient mother who made our life, filled our life with love, and who really showed me through, you know, her life how to be self-sufficient and resilient. And when I went, I went to college at the University of Minnesota, and when I first was wanting to go to college when I was a senior in high school, nobody talked to me about college, even though, I mean, it really makes me upset to think about this now, because I was actually this incredibly engaged, overachieving, wildly, you know, like avid reader, you know, the whole thing. And nobody said anything to me about college. And so I didn't know you were supposed to even apply to more than one. And what I did is I got these brochures in the mail like you do when you're a senior in high school. And for any of you who work in like the marketing department where you make these brochures, they matter, because that is how I chose the college to apply to. And I lived in northern Minnesota on 40 acres of land, 20 miles from the nearest town, which was just 400 people. So I was intimidated to apply to the college that I could afford, the University of Minnesota. So I applied to this private Catholic university called St. Thomas in St. Paul. And it was the only place I applied, and they accepted me. And when the acceptance letter came, it said, one benefit if you go here is your parents and your grandparents can take classes for free. And my mother jokingly said, well, I've always wanted to go to college. And the thing is, it was a joke, but it also pierced our hearts, because she had always wanted to go to college. And she had never been able to do that because of money, and she had three kids by the time she was 26 and all these other reasons. And so what, at first, you know, I said, you know, no way, because I was, you know, would any one of you have signed up to bring your mom to college with you? Like, I don't think there's anyone on the whole planet who would agree to that. But what happened is, and I was just as surly as a teenager as anyone else, but what happened is that other truer voice in me said, this is an opportunity, and I do not want to be the person who denies the opportunity to this woman who had sacrificed so much for me. So I said she could go to college with me, but she had to obey one rule, and that is she could not acknowledge me if she saw me unless I acknowledged her. So if I said, it was like I was the queen or something, you know. If I addressed her, she could address me. If I decided to glance past her as if she were nobody, she was to pretend she was nobody. And I lived in the dorm, and it was this private Catholic university that cost an absolute fortune. I was paying for my education, Pell grants, state grants, student loans, and I was working three jobs. And so thank you, taxpayers, for those Pell grants. And you know, I realized this is ridiculous for me to be going to this private school where I, you know, and so in that first year, my mom went to college, and she thought she was going to flunk out, and she got straight A's, and she was like the best student ever. And I told her, you know, look, I want to transfer to the University of Minnesota because I can afford it. And she said, I think that's a grand idea. I'm going to transfer too. So she transferred, but luckily the University of Minnesota has various campuses. So I went in Minneapolis and she went to Duluth, which is closer to our house. Our land is an hour and a half west of Duluth. And so we went to college together. And she died on the Monday of our spring break of our senior year. So she did not, she was two classes shy of her bachelor's degree. And the university.
What a gift.
Yeah, it was a gift. The university granted her degree posthumously.
I want to talk a minute about walking.
Okay.
Because a lot of writers I love, and I'm sure you do too, have written about walking. Rebecca Solnit is one of them, and she talks about how walking has evolved out of the disembodiment of everyday life. And I love that. And then Will Self is another one who writes about walking, and he does things like walk from Kennedy Airport into Manhattan. He does, and he's a really interesting writer, but he says people don't know where they are anymore.
Yeah.
I mean, they don't, because of the way we travel from place to place. And this book, you're walking, so I know that you've thought about walking as you did it, and walking as a metaphor, and just like a couple of reflections from you on walking.
Well, walking is, when I was writing Wild, I had to be careful with using it too metaphorically, because it's such a great metaphor. You know, here I was, my whole challenge in the course of this hike was to continue moving forward. And the entire challenge in the course that was going on inside of me also was that. How do I move forward without my mom? How do I move forward given the mistakes I made and the things I did and the regrets I have? How do I move forward while suffering? You know, these are big, big, gigantic spiritual questions, you know, psychological questions, emotional questions that we're all grappling with all the time. You've all had to ask yourself that in a number of ways, I know. And so to go out on the trail and physically enact physically what I was trying to figure out inside was incredibly restorative. And I also think that this thing you said where you look closely at something. When I was hiking the trail, whenever I would encounter anyone in an automobile, and if I asked them for any kind of directions to get anywhere, I learned really quickly that there was such a huge difference in my perspective and their perspective. Because I would say, well, is there a creek, you know? And they'd go, oh yeah, it's just down the road. It's just right down there. It's really close. Well, you know, then I'm 10 miles later. And see, it's close to them because they're in a car. Mm-hmm. And on foot is different. And so foot speed, it's a powerfully humbling way to see the world. Mm-hmm. And what you see is the world. You see the world up close.
And you also did the trail before cell phones, before iPods.
Yes.
You were really alone.
I was alone. I think that it was like a different world.
Exactly.
I mean, the internet, you know, only Al Gore was on it. I mean,
after he invented it.
That's right. And, you know, I was on the PCT when I first heard of a cell phone. And so for those of you who've read the book, the guy, Albert, the Eagle Scout guy who helped me lighten my load, my pack, took stuff out of my pack, including the condoms, at Kennedy Meadows, he was this lightweight backpacker, but he had this brick of plastic with these numbers on the front. And I said, what is that? And he said, it's this thing called a cell phone that this company is trying to make. And they asked, you know, they had found out he was going on the hike, so they asked him to carry it and to turn it on, like at different steps, to see if it was getting reception. And by the time I'd met him, he'd carried it like 500 miles and it had never once gotten reception. And I remember both of us, without any question, we were scoffing at this thing because it was a preposterous product that we knew nobody would ever have any use for. Because we were like, why would you want to walk around with a phone all the time? Does anyone remember that world? When it seemed like a weird idea that you would carry your phone around with you? And now I'm like so tethered to it, you know, and it's so, but it was only in 1995, and that's, you know, now we could log online and read hundreds of trail journals. People are up there, you know, tweeting from the trail. But no, my communication, if you wanted to get in touch with me, is you would have to write a letter and send it to the post office that you thought maybe I was going to be at in a week or two.
Oh, and there were so many scenes of you waiting for a delivery of something at the post office, and my heart would just break.
My $20.
Oh, your $20. Oh.
But so, you know, that 20, like back to the money thing, every once in a while I'll get an email, or during the Q&A, people go, well, I don't understand. Like, why didn't you bring more money on the trip? And I'm like, because I didn't want to tap into my secret account? I mean, like, what do you think? think. It wasn't like I have this option. Well, I'll bring this money, but not that money, you know. And I was like, I brought all the money I had, you know. And people will say, well, you didn't have enough. And the thing is I actually did have enough. I did have enough. I did the trip, right? I'm here. I had enough. And there's what they're saying is, you did not have enough to be comfortable.
Right.
And there is a big difference between having enough to be comfortable and having enough. And the only way that I was able to take that trip is because I'd grown up the way I did. We never had enough to be comfortable, but we always had enough.
That's exactly it. And when you say nobody writes well about class, I mean, there, Richard Rousseau, there are some people, Russell Banks, but I hope you do, because it's so important, and it's something that particularly those of us who love fiction don't get to read about enough. We have had Audrey and Rich on this stage.
Oh, have you?
And she was such a source, and God rest her soul, she was such a source of comfort to you on the trail, talking about how loss gives you power. What is it about her writing that spoke to you so profoundly?
So many things. I loved, first of all, just the entire spirit with which she wrote, which was fearless, exacting. You know, she had this wonderful sense of, I always think of the word radical when I think of her, and by that I mean what it really means, this kind of the root, the core. And she was always searching for whatever that greatest truth was, you know, whether it was convenient or not. She sort of transcended, you know, she was very political, and yet she always transcended the politics of the day for me. And I loved that she, you know, she explored it. She, in one of her poems, this poem called Power, she talks about one's power coming from the same source as one's wounds. And I think that that's a great summary of who she was as a poet, to me at least, that she really mined her strengths right there in the midst of her weaknesses. And she did that as a person, and she did that, you know, in her poetry she wrote personally about that, but she also did that for us as a people, you know, to really, she had faith, I guess, that beauty could rise out of ugliness, and that you know, redemption out of suffering, all of those things that I think were just so, that she did with such guts, and she would curse me for saying this, but I'm going to say it, balls, you know, and I think that she was brave and wonderful.
Yeah, I'm so happy to see her celebrated this way. I want to turn to another specific scene in the book, because it has a parallel in Dear Sugar. The scene where you're going to have a sexual relationship with this guy, and here you've done this Wonder Woman thing, and you have hiked this trail, and you've done it on your own, and you've survived, and you are powerful, and you are so worried that he's going to see your chapped hips when you have sex with him. And you are just absolutely undone by that. And that brings to mind the Tiny Revolutions, I think, which is one of your Dear Sugar columns, where you talk about the body as a final frontier for women. So here we can achieve, and we can do all these incredible, miraculous, heroic things, and then we think, oh, my feet are ugly, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
What is the problem there?
I know, it's a really, isn't that crazy?
Yes.
I mean, that's an example of, you know, that I, you know, looking back on my younger self, of course, I was shaking my head at that moment, but I also, I had to write the truth at that moment, which was I was afraid to take my pants off. And just, it makes it sound like Wild is full of sex. Actually, I always think it's funny when people criticize, like, oh, she just, you know, fucked her way down the trail. I'm like, I actually only had sex with one person in the whole hike. I think that's rather modest, don't you? I mean, come on. So yeah, it was just this one guy, but we were talking about it several times, just so you know. And so everywhere my pack made contact with my body, it chafed it. And on my hips especially, chafed is a gentle word. It actually turned it into this like really bizarro kind of like rawhide kind of situation. And so I meet this foxy guy, and he's, you know, I end up in his tent with him, you know, on this organic farm, as one does. And and I had gone there thinking, okay, we can do all kinds of stuff, but whatever we do, I can't take my pants off. Because I'm mortified by this stuff on my, like, this, and you know, one thing leads to another, and I do want to take my pants off. And so, but I'm just afraid. So I say to him, look, I'm really self-conscious about this thing, which is mortifying, you know, just to say to somebody. It worked out fine in the end. He, turns out, didn't mind that very much at all, the hip stuff. But, you know, and it was funny looking back, because I have, now that I'm 44, you know, I have noticed that men care way less about that kind of stuff than we think, you know. I think that, you know, I think a lot, yeah. I mean, like, I am like any woman, where I get, you know, really hung up on my own little sort of tiny body issues,
right,
that become ridiculously big, and they sap my sexual self-confidence and my, you know, they make me self-conscious and all of those things, which then get in the way of any kind of actual intimacy or pleasure or whatever. This is like the sex talk tonight, isn't it? So, you know, but it's really messed up, and it's a conundrum in my own life. It's still a conundrum in my life. Like, I am a feminist. I've been a feminist all my life. I have incredibly, you know, sort of strong values about the difference between internal and external beauty and all the crazy stuff our culture does to women. And yet, have I absorbed some of those things? Absolutely. In fact, all of them. And I've had to spend a life trying to push them, to purge them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And so much of what makes you really successful as Dear Sugar is that storytelling you employ when you respond to people, the woman who had insecurity about
right.
her body, and you respond with stories of your own. It's just so effective.
Thank
you. In helping people work through their issues. Just great stuff. You say you made better choices for yourself after the hike, and as it happened, you met the man who would become your husband 9 days after you left the trail.
That's true.
And I know everybody in this audience is dying to know about him, so tell us a little bit about your husband.
Well, some of you might know him as Mr. Sugar. He's a running character. Who knows Mr. Sugar? Let's give a shout for Mr. Sugar. So, and the reason they know him is in my Dear Sugar column, even though I was anonymous up until last year, I would tell true stories from my life. I always knew that I would reveal my identity and that I would, so that my name would be on those columns. I wrote with that consciousness of not being anonymous. But so my husband inevitably became a running character in the columns, you know, everything from, well, you'll just have to read the book. He is, I met him 9 days after I finished the hike at this restaurant just by chance, and he's a documentary filmmaker, and he just has a movie that just came out called Alien Boy. It's been screening in Portland, and he's entering festivals all over. And he's just the most, I mean, he's my hero. I have so much respect for him and who he is. He's a good, wonderful person who does good work in the world. His film Alien Boy is about, it's called The Life and Death of Jim Chassie. Jim Chassie was a 42-year-old man with schizophrenia. And in 2006, he was looking sort of suspicious, according to the police, and they chased him and beat him to death. And he did not commit any crime or do anything wrong to bring about his death. And my husband wanted to tell the story of Jim's life and his death and what happened. And so that's hopefully going to be in San Francisco sometime.
I hope.
Yeah.
And you have 2 children, 7 and 8, a boy and a
yes.
girl. And as somebody who lost her mother, I'm sure you're hyper aware of your mothering of your children. Also the fact that they're growing up without your mother, their grandmother.
Yeah, yeah.
So they're not clearly going to go through the trials and tribulations you went through growing up, but I'm sure you have a consciousness of wanting them to become strong, confident human beings. So as a parent, I guess my question is how to help them do that when their life is going to be a lot easier than yours just
right.
from the get-go.
Well, yeah, it's a really interesting question. And it's something, my husband also grew up working class with a single mom. And so one of the things when I first, that really drew me to Brian, immediately we both, you know, we came from the same pond. He, you know, he's a filmmaker, he has an MFA from Columbia, and yet he grew up like I did, you know. And so we recognized each other and connected. And one of the things, even before, so up until just this past year, we too have always been, you know, broke and living, you know, hand to mouth and all kinds of, you know, hair-raising financial situations. But I always had the consciousness that it was a different kind of poverty than the poverty I grew up in. And, you know, because I always said we were like the impoverished elite, you know. We had master's degrees, our friends, you know, wrote for the New Yorker, you know what I mean? I didn't grow up in, that's not the culture I grew up in. I culture hopped. Mm-hmm. And I could still be, you know, when I was poor in my adult life, I was poor in a different way than I was poor as a kid. Mm-hmm. Because I'm now an educated, you know, well-read, all that sort of stuff. And so my husband and I, even before we actually had any reason to actually worry about our kids having any, you know, piano lessons, we were worried. We were like, well, they're not going to have the same values that we have because they're not going to have the same experiences that we have. And we've had to just sort of accept that it's, I mean, you can't like pretend you're on food stamps, you know? And so it's like you either are or you're not, you know? And so we're just trying to like kind of raise our kids with an awareness of you know, the world. We take them traveling. We took them to Laos and Thailand a few months ago, which, you know, on one hand I was like, my God, I never got to go to Laos and Thailand until now, you know? But we also try to show them the world. That like not everyone gets piano lessons, you know? Mm-hmm. And so we're doing our best, I think, like everyone does. Mm-hmm. And anyone who has had a different kind of childhood than they do as a parent, you know, their lives, their kids have, I think, grapple with this very issue. Mm-hmm. But the upside too is there are so many good things we can give our kids that I didn't get to have, you know? And so the world gets to open itself up in a different kind of way.
One more question. It's the People Magazine question before we go to the audience and get their questions. Film, Reese Witherspoon, is that happening? Is that?
Yeah.
So tell us.
So a few months before Wild came out, I got a film agent and she just, I mean, in the same day that I got the agent, she said, you know, Reese Witherspoon is looking, wants to read your book over the weekend. What do you think? And I was like, that's fine with me. And and I didn't want to get too like worked up about it or anything. But, you know, I have all kinds of different sort of beliefs about things. But what I did is I lit a candle. You know, when in doubt, light a candle. And and so all weekend I would like you know, keep this candle burning. When I was in the house, I used fire safety. But every time I would pass the candle, you know, I'd go, Reese. I would just... So this is a little tip I haven't shared with very many people at all. So I would just say, Reese. And then Monday morning, my cell phone rang, and it was my agent saying, Reese loves it. She wants it. She wants to play you. She wants to talk to you all about it. And I was like, okay. So Reese and I had this really long conversation. And we talked all about the book, and she completely got it, and she was so into it. And she just felt passionate about, I mean, she understood the story. She understood everything I was hoping, you know, one understands about the book. Okay. And so she optioned it, and then she hired, I don't want any part of writing the script. I mean, I wrote the book. The book is my thing. That's what I am. I'm a writer of books. I didn't want to try to do anything else. And so she hired Nick Hornby, who's this fantastic writer. Wow. To write the script, and I was in England in January for the launch of Wild, and I got to hang out with Nick, and he had just finished writing the screenplay. And so when we met up, he was like, it was so strange, because he'd been thinking really deeply about me for months on end. And so he was just like, I would catch him sort of gazing at me, you know? And I felt sort of watched, you know, in a funny way. But he was so wonderful, and I've just been such a fan of his work forever. So, and I've read the script; it's really good. And the hope is to shoot it this summer. All kinds of Hollywood machinations could go on that would prevent that from happening or make it happen. Or so I don't know. somebody go light a candle and say read. So, because that would be great if it happened, you know, soon. That's, so they're hoping to shoot it soon.
That's terrific. Yeah. Yes. Congratulations.
Thank you.
And now it's your turn.
Thank you. Thank you, guys.
Thanks. So Siri and Jen have the mics. Just put up your hand and they will come to you. If you don't be shy, you're going to be thinking of these questions on your way home and you're going to be sorry.
Don't be shy. You know, the best and worst question has already been asked.
Thanks.
When I was in, I was in Boston, the book had been out a week, and I opened it up and this elderly gentleman in the front row raises his hand and I call on him gratefully and he says, "Have you ever had sex with someone in exchange for food?" And it was one of these things where I had to repeat the question, you know, to the audience. And everyone was just silent, you know. And I'm thinking, you know, and all I could think to say was, you know, "No, but have you had dinner yet?" He had already eaten, I'm sad to say. But,
yeah. So I think we have a question over there.
Yes.
First question on your left.
All right, since we've already have kind of gone down the nosy path, I'm interested in how your feet are doing. And then I also am curious about the rest of your family, because I felt like just as you were really gentle with your ex-husband, you were exceedingly gentle with the rest of your family. And so since we're being nosy and getting up in your business, I'd love to hear a little more about that.
Well, and those are the two most common questions I get. My feet are okay. They're all recovered. The toenails grew back. It did take several years for them to really grow back and be normal again. My hips, soft as a baby's bottom. And my siblings and stepfather, you know, I was gentle with them. And, you know, one of the things that's always hard about writing a memoir is, you know, you're telling your story and I was really willing to, you know, present myself in as truthful a light as I could possibly conjure, even if that showed, you know, negative things about me or things worthy of condemnation. But I didn't want to do that about the other people I was writing about. And sometimes you can't avoid that. Like, you know, there's no way to explain to you, for example, who my father is, my biological father, without, you know, essentially saying he was an abusive tyrant who terrorized my life, you know, for the first 6 years of my life. And yet, strangely, you know, the passage in which I write about that, I mean, it's actually, I tried to make it as condensed as possible. You know, I didn't go on and on and on and on about it. And same with my stepfather, who I love very much and who is a complicated man. You know, in his grief was not able to continue being a father to me and my siblings, and that was a great sorrow in my life. And my friends who were with, you know, who really knew me during that time where he was very much pushing us away, when they read Wild, they said, "Wow, you know, so much, it was so much more dramatic in real life and so much uglier." But I was like, you know, I didn't need to drag him through the mud in that way. You know, I wasn't angry at anyone when I wrote Wild. And I'd come to peace with everyone. And my siblings too, you know, my siblings have big, huge stories. That would be really interesting to tell. But they're their stories, and so I have kept myself from revealing. You know, I wanted to protect their privacy. Mm-hmm. But they're all okay. My brother loved the book. My brother did not even finish high school. He read Wild and spoke to me about it in a way that was as sophisticated as any reader. Mm-hmm. You know, he really was cracked open by the book. And we had the most intimate conversation of our lives after he read it. Mm-hmm.
Wonderful. Next question is down here to your right.
Thank you. Hi. I really enjoyed your book.
Thanks.
My question is more of like logistical, it's not that deep. When I ran out the door tonight, my uncle said, "I'm reading the book. I want to know, did she not try on the pack?" So I did find that when I was reading the book that I felt like so much pain just thinking about how heavy that pack was on your back. And I was wondering if you had any, like, you had no help, like nobody gave you any advice
for the
Well,
book?
The people at REI tried to tell me. They did. I mean, one of the things that, and I don't think I'm alone in this. I mean, but there are a lot of things that, wiser people try to tell you that you don't listen to. Am I alone in this? Has anyone wiser than you ever told you something that you didn't listen to? And then later you thought, oh, okay, yeah. Maybe I should have listened. So I did try my pack on, and I put those little, like, they give you those, like, bean bags, you know, that weigh, like, 7 pounds that they put in the pack and you walk around the store. That was the extent of my trying my pack on. And then, you know, I'm there with all my stuff. I had never packed my pack until the first day, which I know is idiotic, but what can I say? I was an idiot. So, you know, I learned the hard way. And, you know, one thing is, as it's true that I was unprepared in many ways, but the other truth that I think it's overlooked that I will appeal to you to try to remember is I actually did nothing but prepare for the 4 or 5 months before my hike. You know, I had to make those, you know, prepare those boxes and, you know, figure out all the food I was going to eat for 3 months and where it was going to be sent and what supplies I need and where I was going to walk and maps and, I mean, how to use everything. And, you know, so I was actually really preparing, but I skipped over some of the bigger things, like actually putting on the backpack. Yeah.
Did you keep it?
Do
you
still have it? Yeah, I still have it. It's my backpack still.
Next question up top.
Hi, I was wondering, when I was reading your book, I was so taken by how vivid all of your stories and your recollections were and your adventures were, but it took place 15 years before you wrote the book.
Right.
So how did you do that? Did you write stuff down when you just finished the hike and then it took you a while to process, or how did you remember so much?
Well, it's, you know, I did have a journal with me. One of the things that I wish, I mean, other than adding clitoris back into Wild, I think I would have, I mentioned a couple times in Wild that I had a journal and that I wrote in the journal, but people ask me that a lot. Not everyone, I think, realizes that, you know, so many of the, I mean, every day, I was an avid journaler before I took my hike, so it was just a continuation of that, but because I was alone, you know, that was my thing. I would read and write in my journal, and so it was really helpful when I went to write Wild. Like, I could say, you know, I knew where I was on what day and, you know, what the landscape looked like and what I was thinking and feeling. And often, too, conversations, you know, because I was a fiction writer at the time, so I would often write, I would actually do my journal entries the way I would write a scene, where I would have a conversation with somebody and then I would write down, you know, and put it in dialogue, like what we said to each other. So some of the lines in Wild, they're there because I would have forgotten them, but I recorded them in my journal. Things like the miners who I meet when I first, in the first couple of weeks, and they kind of rescue me. And one of the miners, you know, says to me, I never carried a pack that heavy, or except maybe once when I was in Korea and I was being punished. You know, I'd written that down, that he said that, you know, and there was that in a couple, you know, like cool exchanges that I would have lost to time. So there was that. The other piece is the whole deal with memoir, the whole leap of faith that the writer is asking you to make with us is, I'm going to tell you a story to the best of my abilities as I remember it. And I think that people get uncomfortable with that because we have had some people who have lied to us, right? We've had some memoirists who say, oh, you know, I'm actually not going to remember to the best of my abilities. I'm going to say I was a gang member in South, you know, Los Angeles, but really I grew up in the suburbs of San Francisco and went to private school. You know, and so then suddenly the whole form becomes suspect. But really, you know, the memoir is, you know, I'm saying to you, this is, you know, my subjective experience of this time in my life. And even the people I meet, there was the only one person has talked to me about not being crazy about his portrayal in the book. And he felt that, his complaint was that he felt that I made him seem like he was like a total bourgeois guy. And what I said to him is, that's what I thought you were, you know? And I understand now, you know, like, and I said, look, there are like some hipster 20-somethings that see me probably as like this bourgeois person, right? And so, but I was this, you know, 26-year-old who had met this couple, and they just seemed so like nice and settled and secure, and they seemed like members of the bourgeoisie to me. I mean, and so that's the point, is it's not that I'm right about who he was. I'm telling you my perspective of my perception of him. Mm-hmm. And so when it comes to those, first of all, there's the subjectivity, but then also the vivid details. You know, the art of memoir, we want you, you know, to enter the story as if it's like you're reading a novel. We want you, you know, so when I would remember a scene with somebody and I would say the wind blew their hair and their face at that moment, you know, did it? You know, I don't know, but I think it did. You know, that's my memory of it. And so you commit yourself to your memory and you tell a story out of that. I went to great lengths to get as much right as I could, you know, fact-checking and talking to people I met on the trail and so forth. But a bunch of it is, this is my memory. Yeah.
Next question is over here to your right.
Yeah.
Hi. So it's interesting that you talk about memoir because you're very public about a lot of private things that most of us would probably feel quite uncomfortable sharing with the world. It's a gift to all of us, but at the same time, I was wondering if you have any regrets or downsides to that experience.
I don't have any regrets. It's really interesting. I think one of the things that I really feared very much when you know, before I wrote Wild, I was also writing essays that were very personal and such. But really, with Wild, this big leap where, you know, there's this book and I'm writing in a very vulnerable way about myself. And I was terrified because I thought people would hate me and judge me. And the thing is some people do hate me and judge me based on the book. It's true. But the more common experience has been actually a great amount of kindness and generosity and lovingness. There hasn't been, you know, I mean, you know, anytime you publish a book, nasty people are going to write nasty things about you on the internet. You know, so really early on, I decided like I was going to try to shield myself from as much of that as possible, just because, you know, it's you know, there's nothing you can do about that. But there really hasn't been anything that I've felt, gee, I wish I, you know, hadn't said this or that. You know, mostly the experience has been people come to me and say, thank you for writing honestly about that, because I too have had that experience. You know, today I went to Google and I gave a Google talk, and this woman came up to me. Have you any of you been to Google? That is an amazing place. Get a job there, okay? Because for one thing, free food, okay? Breakfast, lunch, and dinner. I was like, are you kidding me? But she was, I was signing her book, and she said, thank you for writing about having an abortion. And I said, you know, I chatted with her about it, and she said, so many people have had that experience, but it's like they're ashamed, so they don't write about it. And I love that. I think that one of the things, you know, I always wanted, you know, in addition to being a writer, I always wanted to sort of do something to make the world a better place, you know, which sounds totally hokey, but it's true. You know, I always wanted to contribute in some way. And I do think that simply telling the truth of the, you know, ordinary human experience can be a powerful way of altering the landscape. And so, you know, I really love that piece of it. Now, the other thing I want to say is I know that I'm really open and vulnerable in my work and that people feel like they know a lot about me because of it. But there's a lot of stuff I don't write about, too. You know, there's a whole realm of things that actually I've never written about and possibly never will. And so just because you know a lot of things about me doesn't mean that you know everything about me. It just seems like you do. And so that's the other thing, is I am very conscious of, like when I said earlier, I always knew that my name would be on the sugar column. The reason that that's important is so that I would make sure not to tell you anything that I ever wanted attached to my name. And so there are things that I have, you know, and usually it's to protect the people I love, you know. What are my true feelings about, and then, you know, name a family member. You know, I'm not going to write them because it would be too painful to that person. You know, so I do keep things back, too.
The other thing you really boldly write about that could be considered really shameful and you could easily have hidden is the heroin.
That's right, yeah.
I mean, you could have left that out easily, but it was part of the story, and it made you so much more vulnerable.
That's right. And so many people have had that experience. I mean, one thing that's been so so striking this past year. I've met thousands of people, and they walk up to me at the book signings, and you know, just like we all do, we see somebody and we think, we make a series of very fast decisions about who they are and what their experiences are, you know. And I've learned, just really, we have no idea. We have no idea. I've had like 90-year-old men come up to me on their walkers, honestly, and say, you know, and just right there, and just tell me, you know, pieces of the book that they related to that you would just never have guessed. Some of those guys, super wild back in the day. It turns out a lot of them have had sex, for example.
Another question up here to your right.
Hi, thank you. I'm wondering to hear more about your editing process. So I want to hear, like, what was one of the hardest editing decisions or ongoing decisions that you had to make? What did you learn through your editing process? When you're editing pieces now, what's something that you take from the editing process of the book?
Editing is such an important part of the process. You know, that first draft of the book is about 30,000 words longer than the published version of the book. And so the process of editing wasn't, you know, taking things out, and it wasn't only taking things out and trimming it down. It was making what's there really matter. And so in some ways, making what's there more dense and rich with, you know, meaning and action and all of those things that your work has to, and energy that your work has to involve. And so to me, you know, what I do is I don't know how to say it, except, you know, I re-enter the work. You know, like I wrote the first draft of Wild, and I waited, and I got notes from my editor and waited a couple months, and then I went back to page one. And one thing that I do, the last thing I did when I sent off each draft, so I wrote a first draft and then two major revisions, and each time I sat there by myself in a room and just read out loud the entire book to myself. And I can hear it if it's right, and I can hear it when it's wrong. The words, you know, sentences, I mean, the whole thing, what matters the most to me is, like, it's on the level of the sentence, like the sentence has to be right. And so I read it out loud to myself. That's incredibly helpful to me. I also listen to other people. You know, the conversation about, I joked about this clitoris thing, but, you know, it's like, it's really a consideration. So my editor is saying to me, I think this sounds too crass. And I'm trying to decide, does it sound too crass, or do I stick to my vision here? And sometimes she was right, and sometimes I was right. One thing that's not in Wild, that's a pretty big thing, that is in Tiny Beautiful Things, is I write about being sexually abused by my grandfather, by my father's father. And it was in the first draft of Wild, and there was this big discussion I had with both my agent and my editor. My agent used to be an editor. She was the editor of my first book, Torch, actually. So they're both people I really trust. And they said, I don't think you need it in the book. I don't think you need to, there's this one scene where my grandfather sexually abuses me and my sister. And they said, I don't think you need it. And I didn't know. And I decided to trust them. I still don't know if that's a good decision. It ended up coming out in a different book, you know, so it's there. But it is, part of editing is just really trying to learn. And there are other things that I fought for and stayed in the book, you know, even though they told me it should be out. And so you do have to sort of find that balance between trusting yourself and trusting other people, which does happen to be exactly what happens in everything, right? Everything from parenting to marriage to, you know, life.
I think we can take two more questions.
Next question on your left.
Oh, geez, it's been a while. I forgot the question. Hang on. the hike you took was pretty horrendous from my non-hiker's viewpoint. I can't imagine ever wanting to go back out on the trail. How long did it take you to ever go back out again? And did you ever return to the Sequoia, Kings Canyon, Yosemite section that I believe you missed?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So this is what's funny. One thing that's really true about any piece of art, any book, anything, is, you know, the book is this one document that doesn't change, and yet it's a different document to each of you. You know, you bring yourselves to that book. And so it's always so funny to me. Some people, the moral of the story of Wild is, I will never fucking go backpacking. And some people, the moral of the story is, you know, they cannot wait to get out on the trail. I mean, I cannot tell you how many toenails I am responsible for having. I get these emails. My girlfriend and I, because of your book, you know, we quit our jobs, we left our husbands, we're, you know, and I'm like, okay, you know, maybe don't pin it all on me, you know, and they're all going hiking now. I mean, they really are. It's like, it's totally like what you, so you bring, you know, that to the book. And I love to backpack. And the other thing is, I think that my love for backpacking is present in the book. I mean, that's the thing that about anything that's hard to do, you know, whether it be writing a book or hiking a long trail or having children, you know, like that. What I found is in all three of those things, is like a good percentage of the time you are absolutely miserable. You know, you're just like, why the fuck did I do this? And you know, like whenever you have a baby and you're like, I used to be able to like go out and like sleep and you know pee with in privacy, you know, and yet. It's counterbalanced by the fact that it's like this amazingly, magnificently beautiful thing that you've done. And that's how it was on the PCT. I was, you know, often in pain and, you know, there were all these complaints I had all the time. But there was also always that feeling of like, wow, you know, this is what life is about. This is the beauty of the world. My mother used to always say, which drove me crazy, one of the things on the list of the things I hated about my mother is that she was so optimistic. And you could never get her down, you know, which just made me crazy. And so she would say, you know, we always have the choice to have beauty in our lives. We always have the opportunity to have beauty in our lives because there's always a sunrise and there's always a sunset. And if you want beauty, you can go, you can have those two things each day. Which I thought, you know, about on the trail, because every day I saw the sunrise and the sunset. And I realized it was like, even when I was losing toenails and, you know, all these things, craving cheeseburgers and lemonade and stuff, I was like, I was in the presence of beauty. I put myself in the way of beauty. And that was an incredibly big gift. So I think you should just go hiking, honey.
We have one last question up here, Cheryl.
Hi, my name is Gail, and I wanted to say you're not only an inspiring writer, you're a really inspiring speaker.
Oh, thank you.
And it's been great tonight.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
A friend of mine who was a kind of unlikely reader, a man, a very non-romantic type, very practical man, told me about Dear Sugar. And then it took me a while till I got to Wild, and then I got to Dear Sugar. And it's been like little wildfires around me as I tell people, my daughter and my friend and her son, and everybody's like loving across genders and age groups. You know, everybody's loving it. What's been most remarkable for me as I talk to people about your writing, and it started with Wild, and when you talk about, you know, the heroine, and you talk about your sex partners. And I had a lot in my youth too, and I'm still kind of like, you know, shaken by my bad behavior or whatever. Uh-huh. That, you know, it was your acceptance of yourself and this quality, and then I saw it in Wild too. I mean, in Tiny Beautiful Things too, is this acceptance that is this incredible non-judgmental quality, along with the compassion and the wisdom, and it's such a rare thing. For ourselves, toward ourselves, as well as toward each other, this lack of judgment. So I don't know what the question is, except this incredible quality of non-judgment that you bring. And if you have anything to say about how we can all do that too.
No, that's great.
That's a big question. So when I revealed my identity as Sugar, it was on Valentine's Day of last year, and I did it in San Francisco. I flew to San Francisco from where I live in Portland, and at the Verde Club, there was this big party. It was a ticketed event, like 300 people. Were any of you in the room that night?
All right, some people, yes, yes, yes. Wasn't it a magical night?
It was so great.
It was amazing. It was like, it was really amazing. And one of the things that I was really insistent on getting, so, you know, when we were planning the party, because it was for the rumpus.net, which is based here in San Francisco, and that's where the column is published. And I said, you know, the one thing, you know, and of course we didn't have any money, and I'm not paid anything to write that column, was never paid a dime. And, you know, so we're trying to piece together this party without spending much money. But I said, you know, I really want to get everyone these fake tattoos that they get at the door. And they said, we are all sugar. And, you know, on this night that I was going to say, no, I'm sugar. But what I really, I'm really sugar. You guys just, no, but what I was trying to say is, you know, what had happened, and for those of you who don't know, like what had happened with the Dear Sugar thing was really, really spectacular. Because I started writing this column that, you know, nobody was, you know, really aware of or reading, and I couldn't advertise it because I was anonymous. And it was completely this homegrown thing where I just started to really put everything into writing the column, like the full force of my humanity and the full force of everything I knew as a writer, everything I knew how to do on the level of craft as a writer. I wasn't going to say, well, this is an advice column, so I'm just going to be kind of stupid. You know, I was like, no, I'm going to give everything. I'm going to make it a literary form. And so I did that, and what happened is people started reading the column. And the way they found it was people would tell, they would go on Twitter and Facebook and say, read this, and they would post a link. And so it grew this cult following. And I loved that there was this, that what it was born of is people sharing it with each other, saying like, I got something from this writing and I found it beautiful and I want to share this beauty with you. And so what happened then is then they became part of creating that beauty. Like it got more beautiful because people were sharing it. And so I felt like it was such a sort of, that community was the embodiment of everything I had hoped to do as Sugar. Which is really just to say, you know, I mean, I don't know what value being judgmental has. You know, what value does that actually have? And there's a difference between being judgmental and saying, I think what you did was wrong. Like, I think it's immoral, or you made a mistake, or you need to change, or it's unacceptable, or I won't tolerate it. That's different than being judgmental. Being judgmental is, you know, putting yourself separate and above somebody, I think. Whereas when you say to somebody, you did a wrong thing, I think that you are acknowledging also that you too have done wrong things. We all have. All of us have. And so I just try to write from that place. I do think that writing is one of the conduits through which, you know, I try I aspire to be my best self in every part of my life, but in my writing, I aspire really ferociously, because I do think that if you're not doing the best writing too, you know. So I don't know. Like you didn't ask a question, but I think that I just thank you for reading it with such an open heart. Thank you.
Thank you all. Thank you, Cheryl Strayed. Wonderful.
Thank you.
Wonderful.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. I didn't know there would be a book. You know, I was a serious writer at the time, and I always think that, you know, anything that happens in, you know, it can end up in anything I write. Half of the things I write about in the sugar column that come from my life, I never imagined I would write about them. And so anything's up for grabs, but I certainly, when I was on the hike, did not think, okay, this would make a great memoir. And in fact, for years, my husband, whose real name is Brian, who I am actually married to, he would say, you should write about the PCT. And I would always say, you know, I don't have anything to say about it. It was an interesting journey, and it would make for great conversation. But until I really had something to say about that experience that transcended the experience. You know, we've all had adventures and traumas and dramas, and that doesn't make a book. And so until I reached that place as a writer and a human, that I understood what this experience meant and felt like I could bring that to bear on the story, I didn't want to write it.
So much of the journey is about your mother's death. It's mm-hmm. really at the center of this book. But you had also written about that in
right.
Torch,
yeah.
in your novel. Mm-hmm. So why did you decide to revisit it? And as you said, you had something else to bring to it. Was it just time and your understanding, or what
right.
was it?
Well, Torch, you know, in Wild, when I say there was this book I was writing in my head, it was Torch. And Torch, that's another reason I couldn't write Wild, because Torch was the book I had to write. Mm-hmm. And I think every writer has that first book that absolutely has to be born. And I needed to tell this story in a fictional way that, you know, is strongly drawing on autobiography. And it wasn't just my story, it was the story of a family and a community. And so I just was passionate about that story. And then when I went to write my next book, I didn't choose to revisit my mother's death or my grief. It was something that I have just been obsessed with as a writer. And so it was like I when I first started writing Wild, I didn't know that my mother's death would actually be such a big part of the book. Mm-hmm. I don't know why, what I was thinking, because it's such a big part of the book. But it was just, it's something that I have had to write about over and over and over again. It's incredibly powerful to me. And I think, you know, and then you see this also in some of the Dear Sugar columns. You know,
yes.
another strand is there. And, you know, this next book I'm writing is a novel, and I haven't gotten very far into it, and I don't think that there are any dead mothers in it, you know? And I'm so happy about that. But I don't know. I mean, that's the thing about writing, is you set out with this intention, and then what you have is something else.
You know, a couple of things about your mother. You mentioned the way you write about your ex-husband, that he wasn't perfect. The way you write about your mother in this book, in Wild, one of the most poignant parts of the book to me is when you addressed her shortcomings.
Mm-hmm.
And you talked about all the things your mother did that
right.
weren't so great. And that just served to make her so much more human.
Right.
And it was just a really beautiful part, I thought.
Thank you.
Of the way you spoke about your mother, because before I thought, oh my God, her mother went to college with her, how cool, and her mother did
right,
this,
right.
and her mother did that, but then you talked about some of the other things that weren't so
right.
great, and it really made her more real and
yeah.
more fully developed, and I was able to better understand the loss in a more real way.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, that was a really hard chapter for me to write, because even though I know otherwise, I think that there is that instinct that we feel when someone we really love dies, that, you know, that you would never speak a word against them, and that in some ways if you do that, that's a betrayal mm-hmm. of that person and your love. But you know, I really needed to do that, and that day on the trail when it was her 50th. Again, for those of you who hasn't read the book, not to shame you. Okay. So.
I think everybody else has memorized it.
Exactly, yeah. Right, exactly. We'll be reciting chapter one together later. So I was about 2 months into my hike, and I woke up, and it was August 18th, my mother's 50th birthday. And she died when she was 45, and I loved her so much. I loved her you know, beyond measure, and she was really my only parent. And so I just had never gotten sort of angry. I'd never felt gone through those feelings that you naturally feel in your teens and early 20s, where it's developmentally appropriate for you to be separating from your parents in some way, and being very critical and condemning them about, you know, things that you think they did wrong, whether you're right or not about that. And so I never got to do that because my mom got sick and died. And then I had to be her loyal daughter. Mm-hmm. And there was something that came unhinged on that day, that it was her 50th birthday. So in this chapter in the book, I write about my rage and I make a list of the things that, all the things that I can think of that my mom did wrong, all the things, the ways that she failed me. And it was like a kind of release, I think, mm-hmm. where I gave myself permission, you know, for in some ways for me to finally do that developmental thing of detaching from my mom and moving on. And she became more human to me too. I mean, one of I would have my mother back in a flash, absolutely. But there are also a few things that have happened because my mom died that I got to learn things. I got to experience things that I couldn't have otherwise, and I got to know things that I couldn't have otherwise. And one of those things is I got to see my mother as a human being much earlier than most people get to see their mothers as a human being. Because I think, I don't know that you can fully do that for some time for most people, because our mothers, of course, are who they are in relation to us. What they give us, what they didn't give us, you know, so much of that relationship is hinged on those things. And when my mom died, and after a few years, it was like I could release her from me, and she could just be a person who wasn't just my mom.
You've become, and I don't know how comfortable you are with this, but you've become something of a guru to people who've lost mothers.
Which is
people
ridiculous.
Come to you with their stories, yeah. but then this plays out in your Dear Sugar columns. You have what Steve Almond, who preceded you as Sugar and gives you all the credit in the world for where you've taken that column, calls radical empathy. Mm-hmm. That clearly comes, that perspective comes from this loss you have. And one of the most painful and effective Dear Sugar columns that I read, was to a man who'd lost his son. And your empathy and the perspective you have in talking to him, and I want you to say a little bit about that, comes out of your pain and your loss.
Absolutely. It's a column called The Obliterated Place. And it was a letter, this man, his 22-year-old son had been killed by a drunk driver. And he said that he was suffering. You know, he was going on in all the ways that you're expected to go on. He, you know, was seeing a counselor, and he was, you know, still working his job, and he had a healthy romantic relationship with his girlfriend, and yet he still could not accept the fact that his son, his only child, had been taken from him. You know, this person he loved more than anyone. And he wrote to me and said, it was a powerful letter, but one of the things he said is, help me be human again. And I, you know, even just talking about this letter, it just makes me feel like I'm just going to burst into tears right now. Because it's so, like, his pain was so powerful. It was just like, it was like so gigantic. It was almost like had a physical manifestation. It was like a gigantic apple or something mm-hmm. you could hold in your hands. And I knew that I had to answer his letter. And I also knew that I didn't know what to give him. And so I grappled with it for days on end. And when what I really realized is, you know, none of us can actually take away each other's suffering. You know, nobody can bring, what I want is my mom back. You know, nobody can give that to me. But what we can give each other is, I think, simply, you know, the presence of our being and the presence of our compassion. And to offer, to witness, in witnessing that kind of giganticness of his grief, I think in some ways it's that we're holding it. Mm-hmm. And by witness, I mean not turn away from it. One of the things that was so painful to me in the years after my mom died is how often people would want to help me by denying the grief or denying even the very existence of my mother, as if maybe I had just forgotten about her if they didn't mention her, you know?
Because you weren't allowed to be sad.
Not allowed to be sad. And so in my response to this man, I say, you know, your grief is gigantic. And your job, like the only thing you can do with it, is to make something of it. And to make it beautiful. And I think that in so many ways, like that's what I've tried to do with my writing, in the writing I've done about my grief, is try to create something that was beautiful out of something that was ugly. Mm. You know?
Mm.
The ugliest thing transformed into a beautiful thing.
Well, that column is in the collection, Tiny Beautiful Things, and if you have not read it, The Obliterated Place, do. Another thing that occurred to me when I was reading Wild, we've had Gabrielle Hamilton here on this mm-hmm. stage who wrote Blood, Bones, and Butter, and one of the things she said that struck me was the fact that she had been poor was really important to who she became. You have been poor.
I have.
And
been.
You have been hungry. And that's something that not many of us have experienced. And that really did make you who you are. Can you talk about that and sort of how that was necessary for
yeah,
you?
Yeah, you know, it's, I think, I mean, we always talk about how class is so hard to talk about. And it is, it's really a hard, I don't know why it's so hard to talk about. But one of the things I hope to do in the course of my writing career is to really figure out how to write better about that and how to shed some light in that sort of thing. But, you know, I would say it affected me, you know, in positive and negative ways, and mostly over time, you know, in the end, positively. I mean, I never had a lesson as a kid. I never went to a camp. I never got to, you know, join anything. I always had...
You didn't have plumbing.
I didn't have a toilet. That's right, yeah. That's true. Good point. So there was that too. I mean, forget it. You can't have piano lessons if you have an outhouse, you know. But you know what I did have is a very resilient mother who filled our life with love, and who really showed me through, you know, her life how to be self-sufficient and resilient. And when I went to college at the University of Minnesota, when I first was wanting to go to college when I was a senior in high school, nobody talked to me about college. Even though, I mean, it really makes me upset to think about this now, because I was actually this incredibly engaged, overachieving, wildly, you know, like avid reader, you know, the whole thing, and nobody said anything to me about college. And so I didn't know you were supposed to even apply to more than one. And what I did is I got these brochures in the mail like you do when you're a senior in high school. And for any of you who work in like the marketing department where you make these brochures, they matter. Because that is how I chose the college to apply to. And I lived in northern Minnesota on 40 acres of land, 20 miles from the nearest town, which was just 400 people. So I was intimidated to apply to the college that I could afford, the University of Minnesota. So I applied to this private Catholic university called St. Thomas in St. Paul. And it was the only place I applied, and they accepted me. And when the acceptance letter came, it said, one benefit if you go here is your parents and your grandparents can take classes for free. And my mother jokingly said, well, I've always wanted to go to college. And the thing is, it was a joke, but it also pierced our hearts, because she had always wanted to go to college. And she had never been able to do that because of money, and she had three kids by the time she was 26 and all these other reasons. And so what, at first, you know, I said, you know, no way, because I was, you know, would any one of you have signed up to bring your mom to college with you? Like, I don't think there's anyone on the whole planet who would agree to that. But what happened is, and I was just as surly as a teenager as anyone else, but what happened is that other truer voice in me said, this is an opportunity, and I do not want to be the person who denies the opportunity to this woman who had sacrificed so much for me. So I said she could go to college with me, but she had to obey one rule, and that is she could not acknowledge me if she saw me unless I acknowledged her. So if I said, it was like I was the queen or something, you know. If I addressed her, she could address me. If I decided to glance past her as if she were nobody, she was to pretend she was nobody. And so, and I lived in the dorm, and it was this private Catholic university that cost an absolute fortune. I was paying for my education, Pell Grants, state grants, student loans, and I was working three jobs. And so thank you, taxpayers, for those Pell Grants. And you know, I realized this is ridiculous for me to be going to this private school where I, you know, and so in that first year, my mom went to college and she thought she was gonna flunk out, and she got straight A's, and she was like the best student ever. And I told her, you know, look, I wanna transfer to the University of Minnesota because I can afford it. And she said, I think that's a grand idea. I'm gonna transfer too. So she transferred, but luckily the University of Minnesota has various campuses. So I went in Minneapolis and she went into Duluth, which is closer to our house. Our land is an hour and a half west of Duluth. And so we went to college together. And she died on the Monday of our spring break of our senior year. So she did not, she was two classes shy of her bachelor's degree. And the university.
What a gift.
Yeah, it was a gift. The university granted her degree posthumously.
I want to talk a minute about walking.
Okay.
Because a lot of writers I love, and I'm sure you do too, have written about walking. Rebecca Solnit is one of them, and she talks about how walking has evolved out of the disembodiment of everyday life. I love that. And then Will Self is another one who writes about walking, and he does things like walk from Kennedy Airport into Manhattan. He does, and he's a really interesting writer, but he says people don't know where they are anymore.
Yeah.
I mean, they don't, because of the way we travel from place to place. And this book, you're walking, so I know that you've thought about walking as you did it, and walking as a metaphor, and just like a couple of reflections from you on walking.
Well, walking is, I had to, when I was writing Wild, I had to be careful with using it too metaphorically, because it is such a great metaphor. You know, here I was, my whole challenge in the course of this hike was to continue moving forward. And the entire challenge in the course that was going on inside of me also was that. Mm-hmm. How do I move forward without my mom? How do I move forward given the mistakes I made and the things I did and the regrets I have? How do I move forward while suffering? You know, these are big, big, gigantic spiritual questions, you know, psychological questions, emotional questions that we're all grappling with all the time. You've all had to ask yourself that in a number of ways, I know. And so to go out on the trail and physically enact physically what I was trying to figure out inside was incredibly restorative. And I also think that this thing you said where you look closely at something. When I was hiking the trail, whenever I would encounter anyone in an automobile, and if I asked them for any kind of directions to get anywhere, I learned really quickly that there was such a huge difference in my perspective and their perspective. Because I would say, well, is there a creek, you know? And they'd go, oh yeah, it's just down the road. It's just right down there. It's really close. Well, you know, then I'm 10 miles later. And see, it's close to them because they're in a car. Mm-hmm. And on foot is different. And so foot speed, it's a powerfully humbling way to see the world. Mm-hmm. And what you see is the world. You see the world up close.
And you also did the trail before cell phones, before iPods.
Yes.
You were really alone.
I was alone. I think that it was like a different world.
Exactly.
I mean, the internet, you know, only Al Gore was on it. I mean,
after he invented it.
That's right. And you know, I was on the PCT when I first heard of a cell phone. And so for those of you who've read the book, the guy Albert, the Eagle Scout guy who helped me lighten my load, my pack, took stuff out of my pack, including the condoms, at Kennedy Meadows, he was this lightweight backpacker, but he had this brick of plastic with these numbers on the front. And I said, what is that? And he said, it's this thing called a cell phone. That this company is trying to make, and they asked, you know, they had found out he was going on this hike, so they asked him to carry it and to turn it on, like, at different steps to see if it was getting reception. And by the time I'd met him, he'd carried it, like, 500 miles, and it had never once gotten reception. And I remember both of us without any question, we were scoffing at this thing because it was a preposterous product that we knew nobody would ever have any use for. Because we were like, why would you want to walk around with a phone all the time? Does anyone remember that world? When it seemed like a weird idea that you would carry your phone around with you? And now I'm like so tethered to it, you know, and it's so, but it was only in 1995, and that's, you know, now we could log online and read hundreds of trail journals. People are up there, you know, tweeting from the trail. But no, my communication, if you wanted to get in touch with me, is you would have to write a letter and send it to the post office that you thought maybe I was going to be at mm-hmm. in a week or two.
Oh, and there were so many scenes of you waiting for a delivery of something at the post office, and my heart would just break.
$20.
Oh, your $20. Oh.
But so, you know, that 20, like back to the money thing, every once in a while I'll get an email, or during the Q&A, people go, well, I don't understand. Like, why didn't you bring more money on the trip? And I'm like, because I didn't want to tap into my secret account. I mean, like what do you think? It wasn't like I have this option. Well, I'll bring this money, but not that money, you know. And I was like, I brought all the money I had, you know. And people will say, well, you didn't have enough. And the thing is I actually did have enough. I did have enough. I did the trip, right?
Right.
I'm here. I had enough. And there's what they're saying is you did not have enough to be comfortable.
Right.
And there is a big difference between having enough to be comfortable and having enough. And the only way that I was able to take that trip is because I'd grown up the way I did. We never had enough to be comfortable, but we always had enough.
That's exactly it. And when you say nobody writes well about class, I mean, there, Richard Rousseau, there are some people, Russell Banks, mm-hmm. but I hope you do, because it's so important, and it's something that particularly those of us who love fiction don't get to read about
right.
enough. We have had Audrey and Rich on this stage.
Oh, have you?
And she was such a source, and God rest her soul, she was such a source of comfort to you
yes.
on the trail, talking about how loss gives you power. What is it about her writing that spoke to you so profoundly?
So many things. I loved, first of all, just the entire spirit with which she wrote, which was fearless, exacting. You know, she had this wonderful sense of, I always think of the word radical when I think of her, and by that I mean what it really means, this kind of the root, the core. And she was always searching for whatever that greatest truth was, you know, whether it was convenient or not. She sort of transcended, you know, she was very political, and yet she always transcended the politics of the day for me. And I loved that she, you know, she explored, she in one of her poems, this poem called Power, she talks about one's power coming from the same source as one's wounds. And I think that that's a great summary of who she was mm-hmm. as a poet, to me at least, mm-hmm. that she really mined her strengths right there in the midst of her weaknesses. Mm-hmm. And she did that as a person, and she did that, you know, in her poetry she wrote personally about that, but she also did that for us as a people, mm-hmm. you know, to really, she had faith, I guess, that beauty could rise out of ugliness, and that you know, redemption out of suffering, all of those things that I think were just so, that she did with such guts, and she would curse me for saying this, but I'm going to say it, balls, you know, and I think that she was brave and wonderful.
Yeah, I'm so happy to see her celebrated this way. I want to turn to another specific scene in the book because it has a parallel in Dear Sugar. The scene where you're going to have a sexual relationship with this guy, and here you've done this Wonder Woman thing, and you have hiked this trail, and you've done it on your own, and you've survived, and you are powerful, and you are so worried that he's going to see your chapped hips
yeah.
when you have sex with him.
I know.
And you are just absolutely undone by that. And that brings to mind the Tiny Revolutions, I think,
yeah.
which is one of your Dear Sugar columns, where you talk about the body as a final frontier
yeah.
for women. So here we can achieve, and we can do all these incredible, miraculous, heroic things, and then we think, oh, my feet are ugly, you know,
that's
or
right,
whatever.
Yeah. Yeah.
What is the problem there?
I know, it's a really, isn't that crazy?
Yes.
I mean,
yes.
That's an example of, you know, that I, you know, looking back on my younger self, of course, I was shaking my head at at that moment. But I also, I had to write the truth at that moment, which was I was afraid to take my pants off. And just, it makes it sound like Wild is full of sex. Actually, I always think it's funny when people criticize, like, oh, she just, you know, fucked her way down the trail. I'm like, I actually only had sex with one person in the whole hike. I think that's rather modest, don't you? I mean, come on. So yeah, it was just this one guy, but we were talking about it several times, just so you know. And so everywhere my pack made contact with my body, it chafed it. And on my hips especially, chafed is a gentle word. It actually turned it into this like really bizarro kind of like rawhide kind of situation. And so I meet this foxy guy and he's, you know, I end up in his tent with him, you know, on this organic farm, as one does. And and I had gone there thinking, okay, we can do all kinds of stuff, but whatever we do, I can't take my pants off. Because I'm mortified by this stuff on my, like this, and you know, one thing leads to another, and I do want to take my pants off. But I'm just afraid. So I say to him, look, I'm really self-conscious about this thing, which is mortifying, you know, just to say to somebody. It worked out fine in the end. He, turns out, didn't mind that very much at all, the hip stuff. But, you know, and it was funny looking back, because I have, now that I'm 44, you know, I have noticed that men care way less about that kind of stuff than we think, you know. I think that, you know, I think a lot, yeah. I mean, like, I am like any woman, where I get, you know, really hung up on my own little sort of tiny body issues, right, that become ridiculously big, and they sap my sexual self-confidence and my, you know, they make me self-conscious and all of those things, which then get in the way of any kind of actual intimacy or pleasure or whatever. This is like the sex talk tonight, isn't it? So, you know, but it's really messed up, and it's a conundrum in my own life. It's still a conundrum in my life. Like, I am a feminist. I've been a feminist all my life. I have incredibly, you know, sort of strong values about the difference between internal and external beauty and all the crazy stuff our culture does to women. And yet, have I absorbed some of those things? Absolutely. In fact, all of them. And I've had to spend a life trying to push them, to purge them.
Mm-hmm. Here tonight, what a great crowd. This is going to be a lot of fun. I'm Barbara Lane. I'm the Director of Arts and Ideas here at the JCCSF. Thank you for coming. Take a moment now, silence your cell phones. You will have an opportunity to ask questions of Cheryl Strayed. Our staff will be out in the audience with microphones. Please wait for them to get to you so your questions are audible. Cheryl Strayed will sign books following tonight's program out in the atrium. Our good friends from Books Inc., one of San Francisco's fine independent bookstores, are here selling books. Yay! We love the independents. So please take advantage of the opportunity to buy a book and have it signed by Cheryl Strayed. Just one quick note on an upcoming program. Mark Maron, the comedian, WTF podcast, will be here on May 16th. We're going to partner with Sketchfest on that. Get your tickets. They're going fast. Did everybody get to see the fashion show tonight? Well, wait a minute. So just a little plug for Ruti. The boutique, it's the brainchild of Ruti Zisser, dedicated to showcasing top Israeli design. All of the designers are Israeli. If you've been to Tel Aviv lately, you know the fashion is just crazy great there. The first Ruti store opened in Palo Alto, and now there are two more, one in San Francisco, right down here on Fillmore Street, and another in Santa Monica. Our staff and friends had a really good time with the fashion show, and we hope you enjoyed it. And now for tonight's program. When she was 22, following the death of her mother and breakup of her marriage, Cheryl Strayed made the decision to hike the Pacific Coast Trail from the Mojave Desert to Washington State, and to do it alone. To say she was spectacularly unprepared is an understatement. Cheryl Strayed recounts that grueling physical and emotional journey in Wild, a book that has resonated with millions of readers in its unflinching depiction of loss and grief and the road to acceptance and recovery. Cheryl Strayed also wrote the novel Torch, and last year she was revealed to be the author of the unconventional advice column Dear Sugar, published online in The Rumpus. Yeah, let's hear it for Sugar. We're delighted to have Cheryl Strayed here tonight. Please join me in welcoming her to the JCCSF.
Hi, everyone.
You are a rock star. You're a rock star.
Well, San Francisco always makes me feel that way.
Well,
so
boy.
Thank you.
But, you know, it occurs to me when I was doing some research for this interview online, people feel such an intimacy with you because of your book, certainly. And they write Cheryl this and Cheryl that as if they really, really know you intimately. They assume a familiarity with mm-hmm. you. But to a large degree, the you they know from Wild is 20-something. And here we are these many years later.
That's right.
So how do you handle that assumption of familiarity?
Well, I'm much milder now, that's for sure. If I followed it Wild up with, it would be called Mild.
And if I
had told the whole story, it would have been called really Wild. But you know,
well,
so
let's start with what you left out.
Yeah, there are some things I left out. The word clitoris is one. Honestly, it's true.
Why?
Because, you know, it's so funny. My editor, Robin Desser, who's this fabulous editor at Knopf, so there, those of you who've read the book, you know, I had sex with... We're just getting right down to it right away, aren't we?
Why waste time?
I had sex with this guy on the beach in Oregon, And in the course of that scene, there was the word clitoris, as there should be, right? I mean, I mean, you know, and so, but she thought it was too sort of porno. And so then I was like, well, how about clit? And she said, that's worse. And then I said, okay, I give up. And so I took it out, and then later I thought, well, I should have probably fought harder for the clitoris. Mm-hmm. So if you could go, you can go to that page in the book and just add that in the marginalia.
So just to get back to this whole idea of intimacy for a moment.
We weren't talking about that kind of intimacy.
Not that kind of intimacy.
But,
they think they know you. And do you think it's because you're, we've all had loss.
Right.
Do you think it's that experience of loss that resonates so much, or something about the nature of the journey you undertook? Or you've spent a lot of time, as we discussed, talking about this book. And it just seems to me a really unusually personal emotional response that people have to it.
Yeah, I think that what they're responding to is certainly that. You know, every time I get an email or have a conversation with somebody about the book, the first line is that they liked Wild, and then the next three paragraphs are essentially their story. You know, what piece of the book resonated with them, what parts of their life or consciousness was sort of sparked or ignited by what they read in Wild, which I think is really interesting. I also started to get so many emails from people who were saying, it's uncanny we have led parallel lives. I mean, I'm sure there are some people in the room who believe yourselves to have lived a life parallel to mine. And at first I thought that was just kind of weird, and then as time passed I realized there are so many of us who feel we live those kinds of lives, and it's because we do, you know, that there is so much more about our very original and unique experiences that are universal, more than we would think. Mm-hmm. And those things, you know, that remains true across cultures, across age and gender and all of those things. I was saying to you earlier, you know, half of my fan mail is from men. Last week met a woman from Korea. She said she was just visiting the United States, and my book has been published there, and she said, you're a celebrity in Korea. And I said, really? I had no idea. And I said, well, what did people say about the book? And she told me what they are saying about the book there, and it's the exact same thing they're saying about the book here, mm-hmm. which I thought was really beautiful.
Yeah.
But I think, too, that thing that you said, that the me that you all got to know in Wild, you know, that the story is the 26-year-old me, but the consciousness is the 44-year-old me, or the 40-year-old me who wrote the book, you know? And so even though in the book I'm not saying in any explicit ways, or at least only towards the end, where I say, you know, this is really me reflecting upon this experience, the consciousness that's behind each word, all of the decisions I made, the way I crafted that story was born out of who I am now.
Well, you do play with time in the book. And so tell me about the decision to structure the book the way you did. Is that how it started out, or did you come to that after experimenting?
Right. So the book, for those of you who haven't read the book, I should say it's about this 1,100-mile hike I took on the PCT in the summer of 95. And one of the things that when I knew that I was going to write about that journey, that immediately gave me a chronology. There's no better way to tell the story of a hike than to start at the beginning and end at the end, right? It doesn't make any sense otherwise. And so what was great is I could hang the rest, the more important story, on the spine of that trail, mm-hmm. of that hike. And so one of the things I came to really right away is that at the beginning of every chapter, you would be on the trail in some way, and you would be further down the trail than you were before. And then from there, I could weave in and out of chronology and essentially tell you what happened before the trail. Who was this woman in this moment of her life? And sometimes, you know, I would spin back in time and I would be six, and sometimes I would spin back in time and it would be 5 months before my hike. Mm-hmm. And that I was really, I guess the most thinking went into, you know, when do I tell you about this versus this?
Did you have stickies all over your wall?
You know, not really. I tend to be, I sort of work very intuitively, and there was a point, so meaning by which I mean I write and I can feel almost, like a heat, like this is the, for example, there's this scene where I meet this man, Greg, and we are in this hotel, and he's in the room next door, and I'm feeling like maybe, you know, at that time in my life, I was just so used to getting essentially love or attention from men through, by being sexually attractive to them, and I'm thinking about, should I approach him and come on to him, essentially, and I thought, you know, just very intuitively that was the place to tell you about my father, you know? So if you read that chapter, there I am in the room, and then we spin back mm-hmm. in time, and I tell you the story of my father and, you know, his abuse of my mother and his role in my life, which was not a positive one. Mm-hmm. And by doing that, I wasn't trying to make a direct line between my sexuality at that age and the fact that I had been abused and abandoned by my father. But I think that putting those things side by side mm-hmm. certainly is psychologically relevant.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Well, I read where you wrote somewhere that becoming hypersexual after suffering loss is not uncommon.
Uh-huh.
And this is something that happened to you. And as I was reading this book, I kept wondering, how does your ex-husband, Mark, feel about your telling?
Well, I call him Paul in the book.
You, sorry?
He's called Paul in the book.
He's called Paul
I don't
in the
know
book?
How you know his real name, but now we all do.
Whoops.
Okay. We're getting real here. So I don't know how he's going to feel about that, but anyway. So Paul, a.k.a. that name that we're forgetting. Okay.
Right. Sorry.
That's okay. So anyway, what was the question? How does he feel?
How did he feel about the revelations of your sexuality? Because you had broken up, but
right.
you were certainly involved with other men before you broke up because you were just so undone
right.
by this loss that uh-huh. you were...
Well, first of all, he knew everything that was in the book. Not that I vetted the book with him, but in our lives, when we were breaking up, it was actually... one of the most powerful experiences I've ever had, because we actually broke up well, You know, we really went very far into our intimacy. We went very far into trying to figure out whether we should come apart or stay together. And we parted with a great amount of love and respect. Mm-hmm. And that never diminished over time. And so actually, when I came to San Francisco last year, almost exactly a year ago, I think it was like April 9th or something, I read at Book Passages, and I went out for dinner afterwards with friends and went back to my hotel room and checked my email. And at this, you know, I was getting hundreds of emails from readers saying, you know, things about the book. And so I'm scanning my email, and I open up this email, and I am midway through reading it when I realize it's from my ex-husband, and he's read the book. And suddenly my heart just, you know, started pounding, and he wrote the kindest email about the book. He thanked me for writing about our relationship so honestly and also gently. You know, of course there are many, many, many things I could have written about our relationship that aren't in the book. You know, he wasn't a perfect human being, he was mm-hmm. a human. Mm-hmm. But there were things that I felt a great amount of responsibility to both tell the truth and, you know, not invade his privacy. You know, I changed his name, I mean, up until now. you know, so just in case he didn't until tonight want to raise his hand and be like, you know, that was me. But what's funny is he has two teenage daughters, and we have a mutual friend who said, oh yeah, the girls are like so excited every time they go to the dentist or whatever, they see Wild in some magazine or, you know. So I was surprised he's shared this with his kids.
And he's proud of you.
Yeah, he is.
So when you decided to take the hike, did you know there'd be a book? And tell us about your journaling process.
Right, my trying my pack on. And then, you know, I'm there with all my stuff. I had never packed my pack until the first day, which I know is idiotic, but what can I say? I was an idiot. So, you know, I learned the hard way. And, you know, one thing is, as it's true that I was unprepared in many ways, but the other truth that I think it's overlooked that I will appeal to you to try to remember is I actually did nothing but prepare for the 4 or 5 months before my hike. You know, I had to make those, you know, prepare those boxes and, you know, figure out all the food I was going to eat for 3 months and where it was going to be sent and what supplies I need and where I was going to walk and maps and, I mean, how to use everything. And, you know, so I was actually really preparing, but I skipped over some of the bigger things, like actually putting on the backpack. Yeah.
Did you keep it?
Still have it. It's my backpack still.
Next question up top.
Hi, I was wondering, when I was reading your book, I was so taken by how vivid all of your stories and your recollections were and your adventures were, but it took place 15 years before you wrote the book.
Right.
So how did you do that? Did you write stuff down when you just finished the hike and then it took you a while to process, or how did you remember so much?
Well, it's, you know, I did have a journal with me. One of the things that I wish, I mean, other than adding clitoris back into Wild, I think I would have, I mentioned a couple times in Wild that I had a journal and that I wrote in the journal. But people ask me that a lot. Not everyone, I think, realizes that, you know, so many of every day I was an avid journaler before I took my hike. So it was just a continuation of that. But because I was alone, you know, that was my thing. I would read and write in my journal. And so it was really helpful when I went to write Wild. Like I could say, you know, I knew where I was on what day and, you know, what the landscape looked like and what I was thinking and feeling. And often too, conversations, you know, because I was a fiction writer at the time. So I would often write, I would actually do my journal entries the way I would write a scene where I would have a conversation with somebody and then I would write down, you know, and put it in dialogue, like what we said to each other. So some of the lines in Wild, they're there because I would have forgotten them, but I recorded them in my journal. Things like the miners who I meet when I first, in the first couple weeks, and they kind of rescue me. And one of the miners, you know, says to me, I never carried a pack that heavy, or except maybe once when I was in Korea and I was being punished. You know, I'd written that down, that he said that, you know, and there's that in a couple, you know, like, cool exchanges that I would have lost to time. So there was that. The other piece is the whole deal with memoir, the whole leap of faith that the writer is asking you to make with us is I'm going to tell you a story to the best of my abilities as I remember it. And I think that people get uncomfortable with that because we have had
some people who have lied to us, right? We've had some memoirists who say, oh, you know, I'm actually not going to remember to the best of my abilities. I'm going to say I was a gang member in South, you know, Los Angeles, but really I grew up in the suburbs of San Francisco and went to private school. You know, and then suddenly the whole form becomes suspect. But really, you know, the memoir is, you know, I'm saying to you, this is you know, my subjective experience of this time in my life. And even the people I meet, there was the only one person has talked to me about not being crazy about his portrayal in the book. And he felt that, his complaint was that he felt that I made him seem like he was like a total bourgeois guy. And what I said to him is, that's what I thought you were, you know? And I understand now, you know, like, and I said, look, there are like some hipster 20-somethings that see me probably as like this bourgeois person, right? And so, but I was this, you know, 26-year-old who had met this couple, and they just seemed so like nice and settled and secure, and they seemed like members of the bourgeoisie to me. I mean, and so that's the point. It's not that I'm right about who he was. I'm telling you my perspective of my perception of him. Mm-hmm. And so when it comes to those, first of all, there's the subjectivity, but then also the vivid details. You know, the art of memoir, we want you, you know, to enter the story as if it's like you're reading a novel. We want you, you know, so when I would remember a scene with somebody and I would say the wind blew their hair and their face at that moment, you know, did it? You know, I don't know, but I think it did. You know, that's my memory of it. And so you commit yourself to your memory and you tell a story out of that. I went to great lengths to get as much right as I could, you know, fact-checking and talking to people I met on the trail and so forth. But a bunch of it is, this is my memory. Yeah.
Next question is over here to your right.
Yeah.
Hi. So it's interesting that you talk about memoir because you're very public about a lot of private things that most of us would probably feel quite uncomfortable sharing with the world. It's a gift to all of us, but at the same time, I was wondering if you have any regrets or downsides to that experience.
I don't have any regrets. It's really interesting. I think one of the things that I've really feared very much when I before I wrote Wild, I was also writing essays that were very personal and such. But really with Wild, this big leap where, you know, there's this book and I'm writing in a very vulnerable way about myself. And I was terrified because I thought people would hate me and judge me. And the thing is some people do hate me and judge me based on the book. It's true. But the more common experience has been actually a great amount of kindness and generosity and lovingness. There hasn't been, you know, I mean, you know, anytime you publish a book, nasty people are gonna write nasty things about you on the internet, you know? So really early on, I decided like I was gonna try to shield myself from as much of that as possible just because, you know, it's you know, there's nothing you can do about that. But there really hasn't been anything that I've felt, gee, I wish I, you know, hadn't said this or that, you know? Mostly the experience has been people come to me and say, thank you for writing honestly about that because I too have had that experience. You know, today I went to Google and I gave a Google talk and this woman came up to me. Have you, any of you been to Google? That is an amazing place. Get a job there, okay? Because for one thing, free food, okay? Breakfast, lunch, and dinner. I was like, are you kidding me? But she was, I was signing her book and she said, thank you for writing about having an abortion. And I said, you know, I chatted with her about it. And she said, so many people have had that experience, but they're ashamed, so they don't write about it. And I love that. I think that one of the things, you know, I always wanted, you know, in addition to being a writer, I always wanted to sort of do something to make the world a better place. You know, which sounds totally hokey, but it's true. You know, I always wanted to contribute in some way. And I do think that simply telling the truth of the, you know, ordinary human experience can be a powerful way of altering the landscape. And so, you know, I really love that piece of it. Now, the other thing I want to say is I know that I'm really open and vulnerable in my work and that people feel like they know a lot about me because of it. But there's a lot of stuff I don't write about, too.
You know, there's a whole realm of things that actually I've never written about and possibly never will. And so just because you know a lot of things about me doesn't mean that you know everything about me. It just seems like you do. And so that's the other thing, is I am very conscious of, like when I said earlier, I always knew that my name would be on the sugar column. The reason that that's important is so that I would make sure not to tell you anything that I ever wanted attached to my name. And so there are things that I have, you know, and usually it's to protect the people I love, you know. What are my true feelings about, and then, you know, name a family member. You know, I'm not going to write them because it would be too painful to that person. You know, so I do keep things back, too.
The other thing you really boldly write about that could be considered really shameful and you could easily have hidden is the heroin.
That's right, yeah.
I mean, you could have left that out easily, but it was part of the story, and it made you so much more vulnerable.
That's right. And so many people have had that experience. I mean, one thing that's been so striking this past year, I've met thousands of people, and they walk up to me at the book signings, and, you know, just like we all do, we see somebody, and we think, we make a series of very fast decisions about who they are and what their experiences are, you know, and I've learned, just really, we have no idea. We have no idea. I've had, like, 90-year-old men come up to me on their walkers, honestly, and say, you know, and just right there and just tell me, you know, pieces of the book that they related to that you would just never have guessed. Some of those guys, super wild back in the day. It turns out a lot of them have had sex, for example.
Another question up here to your right.
Hi, thank you. I'm wondering to hear more about your editing process. So I want to hear, like, what was one of the hardest editing decisions or ongoing decisions that you had to make? What did you learn through your editing process? When you're editing pieces now, what's something that you take from the editing process of the book?
Editing is such an important part of the process. You know, that first draft of the book is about 30,000 words longer than the published version of the book. And so the process of editing wasn't, you know, taking things out, and it wasn't only taking things out and trimming it down. It was making what's there really matter. And so in some ways, making what's there more dense and rich with, you know, meaning and action and all of those things that your work has to, and energy that your work has to involve. And so to me, you know, what I do is I don't know how to say it except, you know, I re-enter the work, you know, like I wrote the first draft of Wild, and I waited, and I got notes from my editor, and waited a couple months, and then I went back to page one. And one thing that I do, the last thing I did when I sent off each draft, so I wrote a first draft and then two major revisions, and each time I sat there by myself in a room and just read out loud the entire book to myself. And I'm really, I can hear it if it's right, and I can hear it when it's wrong. The words, you know, sentences, I mean, the whole thing, what matters the most to me is, like, it's on the level of the sentence, like the sentence has to be right. And so I read it out loud to myself. That's incredibly helpful to me. I also listen to other people. You know, the conversation about, I'm joking, I joked about this clitoris thing, but, you know, it's like, it's really a consideration. So my editor is saying to me, I think this sounds too crass. And I'm trying to decide, does it sound too crass, or do I stick to my vision here? And sometimes she was right, and sometimes I was right. One thing that's not in Wild, that's a pretty big thing, that is in Tiny Beautiful Things, is I write about being sexually abused by my grandfather, by my father's father. And it was in the first draft of Wild, and there was this big discussion I had with both my agent and my editor. My agent used to be an editor. She was the editor of my first book, Torch, actually. So they're both people I really trust. And they said, I don't think you need it in the book. I don't think you need to, there's this one scene where my grandfather sexually abuses me and my sister. And they said, I don't think you need it. And I didn't know. And I decided to trust them. I still don't know if that's a good decision. It ended up coming out in a different book, you know, so it's there. But it is, part of editing is just really trying to learn. And there are other things that I fought for and stayed in the book, you know, even though they told me it should be out. And so you do have to sort of find that balance between trusting yourself and trusting other people, which does happen to be exactly what happens in everything, right? Everything from parenting to marriage to, you know, life.
I think we can take two more questions.
Next question on your left.
Oh, geez, it's been a while. I forgot the question. Hang on. the hike you took was pretty horrendous from my non-hiker's viewpoint. I can't imagine ever wanting to go back out on the trail. How long did it take you to ever go back out again? And did you?
Yeah.
And so much of what makes you really successful as Dear Sugar is that storytelling you employ when you respond to people. The woman who had insecurity about
right.
her body, and you respond with stories of your own. It's just so effective in helping people work through their issues. Just great stuff. You say you made better choices for yourself after the hike, and as it happened, you met the man who would become your husband 9 days after you left the trail.
That's true.
And I know everybody in this audience is dying to know about him, so tell us a little bit about your husband.
Well, some of you might know him as Mr. Sugar. He's a running character. Who knows Mr. Sugar? Let's give a shout for Mr. Sugar. So, and the reason they know him is in my Dear Sugar column, even though I was anonymous up until last year, I would tell true stories from my life. I always knew that I would reveal my identity and that I would, so that my name would be on those columns. I wrote with that consciousness of not being anonymous. But so my husband inevitably became a running character in the columns, you know, everything from, well, you'll just have to read the book. And so he is, I met him 9 days after I finished the hike at this restaurant just by chance. And he's a documentary filmmaker. And he just has a movie that just came out called Alien Boy. It's been screening in Portland, and he's entering festivals all over. And he's just the most, I mean, he's my hero. I have so much respect for him and who he is. He's a good, wonderful person who does good work in the world. His film Alien Boy is about, it's called The Life and Death of Jim Chassie. Jim Chassie was a 42-year-old man with schizophrenia. And in 2006, he was looking sort of suspicious, according to the police, and they chased him and beat him to death. And he did not commit any crime or do anything wrong to bring about his death. And my husband wanted to tell the story of Jim's life and his death and what happened. And so that's hopefully going to be in San Francisco sometime.
I hope.
Yeah.
And you have two children, 7 and 8, a boy and a
yes.
girl. And as somebody who lost her mother, I'm sure you're hyper aware of your mothering of your children, also the fact that they're growing up without your mother, their grandmother.
Yeah, yeah.
So they're not clearly going to go through the trials and tribulations you went through growing up, but I'm sure you have a consciousness of wanting them to become strong, confident human beings. So as a parent, I guess my question is how to help them do that when their life is going to be a lot easier than yours just
right.
from the get-go.
Well, yeah, it's a really interesting question. And it's something, my husband also grew up working class with a single mom. And so one of the things when I first, that really drew me to Brian, immediately we both, you know, we came from the same pond. He, you know, he's a filmmaker, he has an MFA from Columbia, and yet he grew up like I did, you know. And so we recognized each other and connected. And one of the things, even before, so up until just this past year, we too have always been, you know, broke and living, you know, hand to mouth and all kinds of, you know, hair-raising financial situations. But I always had the consciousness that it was a different kind of poverty than the poverty I grew up in. And, you know, because I always said we were like the impoverished elite, you know. We had master's degrees, our friends, you know, wrote for The New Yorker, you know what I mean? I didn't grow up in, that's not the culture I grew up in. I culture hopped. Mm-hmm. And I could still be, you know, when I was poor in my adult life, I was poor in a different way than I was poor as a kid. because I'm now an educated, you know, well-read, all that sort of stuff. And so my husband and I, even before we actually had any reason to actually worry about our kids having any, piano lessons, we were worried. We were like, well, they're not going to have the same values that we have because they're not going to have the same experiences that we have. And we've had to just sort of accept that it's, I mean, you can't like pretend you're on food stamps, you know? And so it's like you either are or you're not, you know? And so we're just trying to like kind of raise our kids with an awareness of you know, the world. We take them traveling. We took them to Laos and Thailand a few months ago, which, you know, on one hand I was like, my God, I never got to go to Laos and Thailand until now, you know? But we also try to show them the world. That like not everyone gets piano lessons, you know, mm-hmm. And so we're doing our best. I think like everyone does, mm-hmm. And anyone who has had a different kind of childhood than they do as a parent, you know, their lives their kids have, I think, grapple with this very issue. Mm-hmm. But the upside too is there are so many good things we can give our kids that I didn't get to have, you know, and so the world gets to open itself up in a different kind of way.
One more question. It's the People Magazine question before we go to the audience and get their questions. Film, Reese Witherspoon, is that happening? Is that...
Yeah.
So tell us.
So a few months before Wild came out, I got a film agent and she just, I mean, in the same day that I got the agent, she said, Reese Witherspoon is looking, wants to read your book over the weekend. What do you think? And I was like, that's fine with me. And and I didn't want to get too like worked up about it or anything, but you know, I have all kinds of different beliefs about things, but what I did is I lit a candle, you know, when in doubt, light a candle. And and so all weekend I would like, you know, keep this candle burning. When I was in the house, I used fire safety. But every time I would pass the candle, you know, I'd go, Reese. I would just... So this is a little tip I haven't shared with very many people at all. So I would just say, Reese. And then Monday morning, my cell phone rang, and it was my agent saying, Reese loves it. She wants it. She wants to play you. She wants to talk to you all about it. And I was like, okay. So Reese and I had this really long conversation. And we talked all about the book, and she completely got it, and she was so into it. And she just felt passionate about, I mean, she understood the story. She understood everything I was hoping, you know, one understands about the book. And so she optioned it, and then she hired, I don't want any part of writing the script. I mean, I wrote the book. The book is my thing. That's what I am. I'm a writer of books. I didn't want to try to do anything else. And so she hired Nick Hornby, who's this fantastic writer. Wow. To write the script, and I was in England in January for the launch of Wild, and I got to hang out with Nick, and he had just finished writing the screenplay. And so when we met up, he was like, it was so strange because he'd been thinking really deeply about me for months on end. And so he was just like, I would catch him sort of gazing at me, you know? And I felt sort of watched, you know, in a funny way. But he was so wonderful, and I've just been such a fan of his work forever. So, and I've read the script; it's really good. And the hope is to shoot it this summer. All kinds of Hollywood machinations could go on that would prevent that from happening or make it happen. Or so I don't know. I'm gonna somebody go light a candle and say Reese. So, because that would be great if it happened, you know, soon. That's, so they're hoping to shoot
that's
it soon.
Terrific. Yeah. Yes. Congratulations.
Thank you.
And now it's your turn.
Thank you. Thank you, guys.
Thanks. So, Siri and Jen have the mics. Just put up your hand and they will come to you. If you don't be shy, you're going to be thinking of these questions on your way home and you're going to be sorry.
Don't be shy. You know, the best and worst question has already been asked.
thanks.
When I was in... I was in Boston... The book had been out a week, and I opened it up, and this man, this elderly gentleman in the front row, raises his hand, and I call on him gratefully, and he says, have you ever had sex with someone in exchange for food? And it was one of these things where I had to repeat the question, you know, to the audience.
And everyone was just silent, you know? And I'm thinking, you know, and all I could think to say was, you know, no, but have you had dinner yet? He had already eaten, I'm sad to say, but.
So I think we have a question over there.
Yes.
First question on your left.
All right, since we've already have kind of gone down the nosy path, I'm interested in how your feet are doing. And then I also am curious about the rest of your family, because I felt like just as you were really gentle with your ex-husband, you were exceedingly gentle with the rest of your family. And so since we're being nosy and getting up in your business, I'd love to hear a little more about that.
Well, and those are the two most common questions I get. My feet are okay. They're all recovered. The toenails grew back. It did take several years for them to really grow back and be normal again. My hips, soft as a baby's bottom. And my siblings and stepfather, you know, it's true, I was gentle with them. And, you know, one of the things that's always hard about writing a memoir is, you know, you're telling your story and I was really willing to present myself in as truthful a light as I could possibly conjure, even if that showed, you know, negative things about me or things worthy of condemnation. But I didn't want to do that about the other people I was writing about. And sometimes you can't avoid that. Like, you know, there's no way to explain to you, for example, who my father is, my biological father, without, you know, essentially saying he was an abusive tyrant who terrorized my life, you know, for the first 6 years of my life. And yet, strangely, you know, the passage in which I write about that, I mean, it's actually, I tried to make it as condensed as possible. You know, I didn't go on and on and on and on about it. And same with my stepfather, who I love very much and who is a complicated man. You know, in his grief was not able to continue being a father to me and my siblings, and that was a great sorrow in my life. And my friends who were with, you know, who really knew me during that time where he was very much pushing us away, when they read Wild, they said, wow, you know, it was so much more dramatic in real life and so much uglier. But I was like, you know, I didn't need to drag him through the mud in that way. You know, I wasn't angry at anyone when I wrote Wild. And I'd come to peace with everyone. And my siblings too, you know, my siblings have big, huge stories that would be really interesting to tell. But they're their stories, and so I have kept myself from revealing. You know, I wanted to protect their privacy. Mm-hmm. But they're all okay. My brother loved the book. My brother did not even finish high school. He read Wild and spoke to me about it in a way that was as sophisticated as any reader. Mm-hmm. You know, he really was cracked open by the book. And we had the most intimate conversation of our lives after he read it. Mm-hmm.
Wonderful. Next question is down here to your right.
Thank you. Hi. I really enjoyed your book.
Thanks.
My question is more of like logistical, it's not that deep. When I ran out the door tonight, my uncle said, I'm reading the book, I wanna know, did she not try on the pack? So I did find that when I was reading the book that I felt like so much pain just thinking about how heavy that pack was on your back. And so I was wondering if you had any, like, you had no help, like nobody gave you any advice.
The people at REI tried to tell me. They did. I mean, one of the things and I don't think I'm alone in this. I mean, but there are a lot of things that wiser people try to tell you that you don't listen to. Am I alone in this? Has anyone wiser than you ever told you something that you didn't listen to? And then later you thought, oh, okay, yeah. Maybe I should have listened. So I did try my pack on, and I put those little, like, they give you those, like, bean bags, you know, that weigh, like, 7 pounds that they put in the pack and you walk around the store. That was the extent